Thank you, Norbert, and thanks a lot to the committee for inviting me. It's a pleasure to be here. I will talk about the fineness of security, and I was actually thinking a bit about the title. The original title I had was that one. You know, it's all about epsilons, which sounds a bit boring, but I will come back to that and hopefully convince you that this can be very hotly debated. So what is this all about? So maybe the main take-home messages, just to start with them, is that security is always finite. We never have perfect security in the sense that there is a zero risk. So there is always a positive, in that sense, finite risk. And therefore, because it's never zero, we of course need to know how to quantify it. As soon as we have to give a number, or as long as it's not zero, we have to understand what this number means. Otherwise, we kind of make rather empty statements. So in other words, what we are doing, and I think yesterday in Christoph Marquardt's talk, it was put very nicely. He said something like, we shouldn't just let the engineers go and develop the devices themselves. We should interact with them. And on this picture on the left-hand side, you probably see what the engineers would produce. And in particular, from my point of view, this is really a black box. So I don't see why this is secure, but of course what we are doing, and that's not the task of the engineers, but probably of the computer scientists, of the physicists, of the mathematicians who develop techniques, is to understand, to model these devices, to model the world around them. We have to model the whole world because at the end we want to have security against any possible attack, and then make a claim. And the claim is maybe something like that, which should also be sold together with the device. So the device on the left is essentially completely useless without this certificate, because as Christoph said, it's easy to see that it works in the sense that you can actually communicate. Bob receives the message from Alice. But to ensure that Eve, the adversary, doesn't receive the message, needs additional work. And that you never see if you just look at the box from the outside. So you need to do an analysis. And this analysis is what people working on security proofs, and I guess there are many here, and of course Norbert is probably the real pioneer because he attributed that to me, and is one of them. So as I said, this sounds a bit boring. I was already complaining to Anne yesterday when we briefly talked that I was asked to talk about a very boring topic. But actually, it's really, in some way, the crucial thing. Because what I'm talking about is really the main figure of merit that we are interested in when we produce, or when we, for example, sell a QKD device to a customer. Because at the end, the customer needs to know what he gets, and what he gets is security, and as I said, security is quantified, and how much security he gets is always depending kind of on the resources. So you should understand this graph as something which is actually maybe in some way multidimensional. So these resources is usually not just one axis, it's like in relativity, a space diagram, the whole space is here drawn on one axis. So resources can be different things, like the number of signals you have to send, the quality of the devices, so it's more costly to have a high quality channel, and so on. And so the more resources you put in, the higher security you get. I mean, I plot this graph for a fixed key length. Of course, the more resources you put in, you can also get more key. But once you fix the key length, then you can see that the security you get is essentially a function of the resources you put in. So that's really the reason why we need to analyze security and to understand what this axis means, because we will be at a certain point on this axis. And we need to know where we need to go in order to know how much resources we need to put in. So for example, a question is, if someone tells you the security is 10 to the minus 5, does this mean I can use it for my particular application I have in mind? And if not, I need to invest more resources. Okay, so that's the setup, but maybe the main proof that this is really not a boring thing is the fact that it's indeed very hotly debated. So this is one of these hot debates at the conference, which was called Hot PI. And you see here the Hot PI sitting behind a table. And this was a debate exactly about what this epsilon actually means. So maybe some of you or those who care about security have seen that there was quite a long debate also, for example, on the archive with papers like this one, where the claim is essentially that the security definitions that we are using and that are in some way, I would say, used in most of the modern security proofs are flawed. So the specific claim is maybe, as an example, put here. So that's one claim that people make. And I think one has to take this serious, because if you ask people who are a bit outside of the community, they read that and they get the impression that there is indeed a problem with security proofs, or at least it's not settled what it means. So you see, the claim is really that there is a fundamental mistake which has become a standard interpretation in QKD. And one goal here, of course, of this tutorial is to tell you how security is defined so that you can make your own opinion. Obviously, I don't want to drag you in one direction. You should get your own opinion. But so let me try to be neutral. Anyway, so this conference, by the way, that I mentioned before, this was also in China. It's one of, let's say, my most memorable conferences that I've attended. Luckily, I had some support by Eleni Diamanti, who is also on the picture. There's also Mauro D'Ariano and Vadim Makarov. And on the right is Horace Wen, who has written maybe, yes, dozens of such papers. So let's now see what this really means. So as I said, what we need to produce as, let's say, quantum cryptographers, or at least as theorists in quantum cryptography, or not manufacturing devices, well, I need to produce security proofs which at the end state such a number. And this number has to have a meaning, and roughly the claim, what this number means, is that it's what I sometimes call a failure probability. And of course, I will explain what that means in more detail, but you should really understand it as if you get this certificate, you can be certain that if you push the button on the device and produce a key, the probability that there is a problem with that key is bounded by this number that is written here. So where does this epsilon actually come? I mean, why is there a number? Why is this not zero? Why can't we just say we want to have a device and where we press a button and then we get a perfect key? Because usually people claim that quantum can produce perfect security. Of course, it's still kind of perfect, but you see, we have always statistical fluctuations. And maybe a nice way to understand this is to take the same cartoon that Thomas used yesterday in his talk. You see, whenever we make random choices, there is always a certain probability, of course, that a choice happens which doesn't look very random. And it could indeed be that from the viewpoint of an adversary, one choice is particularly favorable. I mean, an adversary could, for example, just assume that the randomness that Alice and Bob produce is exactly this sequence 999999. And he can design his attack exactly to succeed in this case. And of course, if he knows what Alice and Bob choose, so he makes this assumption that he knows that, and then his attack would succeed. There is always a non-zero probability that his guess is correct, in which case the scheme is broken. So this is essentially the reason why we can never hope to get security which has a zero epsilon in that sense, because there's always this finite probability that the adversary is just lucky and makes the right choices. So to be a bit more precise, what does it mean to make the right choices? So I took here this original proposal, which is in the BB84 paper, where you can see the main point, of course, in QKD, or a main task of Alice and Bob is to make these random choices. So you need to choose a random basis, And so if the adversary guesses this line correctly, which is of course extremely unlikely, but if he does so, he knows the key for certain. But even if he only guesses maybe a certain fraction of them correctly, but a fraction which is larger than what we usually expect, he may already get significant information about the key. So that's essentially what we have to deal with. So again, it's important to note that this risk cannot be brought down to zero. Now, maybe to put this in context, and in order for us to understand how we should really choose this number epsilon, it's maybe good to think about other risks. And usually when we talk about risks, we think of risks as having different levels of how severe they are. Just as an example, I took this map of Switzerland, which shows you the risk of earthquakes. So actually what it shows you here is that the strength of an earthquake that you have to expect, which could happen within 50 years with a probability of 0.5%. So that's kind of a low probability. It's unlikely I will see such an earthquake in my life, but I kind of could use that as a guideline to construct the house. So I could say, okay, if my house doesn't withstand that particular acceleration, which is given here, then I should expect that with a chance of 1%, it will probably collapse in 100 years or so. Now, the point is that here we have a kind of simpler situation in the sense that there is really something which you can measure, so in principle. So any event has an earthquake has an amplitude, and the stronger this amplitude is, the more damage is caused. Now, in quantum cryptography, it's a bit more difficult to say what it means, for example, if one bit of key leaks. This sounds less severe than if the whole key leaks. So suppose you produce 1 million key bits and one bit leaks. Is this now really less problematic than if all the bits leak? So here, take that theorists, or the approach by theorists is to say, let's not attempt and try to quantify that. Let's just assume that even leaking one single bit can potentially lead to a huge damage. I mean, it could be that this is just the one bit I really wanted to hide. So what we would like to do is to kind of make a statement that with a high probability, really nothing leaks, and the probability by which something else happens is just so small that we don't need to worry about. So it's kind of more an all or nothing statement that we are making. And this is important to understand. So this certificate is really to be understood that with probability 1 minus epsilon, we are just in the perfect situation. And again, I will make that statement more precise later, because that's the critical point that people often have difficulties with. But the goal is really to make this statement. With probability 1 minus epsilon, we have actually a perfect key. And with probability at most epsilon, something else happens. So something else doesn't mean that the whole key leaks. It could be that one bit leaks. But we just don't want to worry about that. This epsilon should be so small that we don't worry about the other case. In some sense, this is comparable to other computations that we do in engineering. So I think DBA is a term used in the construction of nuclear power plants. It means design-based accidents. So this is essentially the type of accidents that you can avoid by proper design. But you can never avoid them perfectly. Again, any technical component has a certain risk of breaking down. We know that. Every airplane, every car, everything has a certain risk. Every component has a certain probability that it breaks down. However careful we are in the design. And so we have a finite number and need to quantify that. And so again, we use certificates there. And so one should, in some way, think of the epsilon in QKD in a similar way. So again, it's important to be aware that this risk can never be zero. How does this actually look like in conventional cryptography? So maybe you may ask if this, I mean, classical cryptography. By the way, people who work in classical cryptography don't usually like this term classical, so I don't mean it negative, but these people don't want to be classical. So nevertheless, so the people in classical cryptography, they of course should have this, should be aware of this problem since a long time, because obviously one would expect them also to make statements about the security of the keys they generate. And let's take as an example RSA key generation. And a company selling a device that generates RSA keys should in some way also be expected to make a statement about how secure these keys are. But now the problem is that there the statements are much less clean than the statements we can make in QKD, and of course also much weaker. Which is another reason why we should really be careful about the epsilon, because this is really the main point where QKD has an advantage. So what is the statement that we can make in conventional cryptography? It's usually a statement of the following form. You could also say that, in principle, we could think of an adversary who tries to gain information about the key. And by information, I mean that he can really extract certain key bits. Of course, in an information theoretic understanding, he always has full information about the key. But let's suppose we ask, how likely is it that he can extract a key bit? Or a message bit that is at the end set. So in principle, if he had a very good computational model, and which he would all agree on, we could actually name a probability. This is usually not done, because we would first have to agree exactly on the type of computational model. And we could say, we could give maybe a graph which says that after so and so many computational steps, or after that much time, the probability that the adversary successfully extracts a key bit is epsilon. Now, the big problem is that we don't know what this epsilon is, because in order to calculate epsilon, we would have to maximize over all possible algorithms that would try to break RSA. Nevertheless, one can make a statement, and the statement that is usually made is of the form that this epsilon is somehow related to the probability that we can factor large numbers, as you know. And if you look at this a bit carefully, it would be not correct to say that the probability by which you can factor numbers in a certain time t corresponds to the probability by which you can break RSA. So it's a bit less favorable. And the actual proofs only show that, for example, I don't know what this is a polynomial, poly t. But for example, that if we can not break or not factor numbers in time t squared, for example, then we cannot break RSA in time t. So there is even a kind of transition from the factoring problem to RSA, which comes from the type of proofs that are used, which are based on reductions. Okay, that's just a small remark for those who are interested in these more detailed statements, but the bottom line is maybe the following. If we talk about QKD, we can really, at the end, make a claim of the following sort. And now the x-axis is no longer the resources, but the time. So this is a different graph from the one I showed before. So the idea is that we can really have long-term security in the sense that the probability that an adversary gets information about the key is just bounded by a number that stays fixed for all times. Now, how would the same quantification of security look like for a conventional crypto system? And this is now just a guess, but maybe it looks something like that. That's a possible shape of the curve. So what does it mean? Of course, the security, so this is now to be understood as the probability that the adversary can gain the key. And of course, this probability grows. So here he essentially knows the key, and it grows with time. Because computers get better and better, and also he has more and more time to actually work on breaking the key. And this should just be understood qualitatively. So I'm not sure what the numbers will be, because this depends again on the computational model and on the algorithms. So this will of course drop, and this will always get lower and lower. Now there's an additional problem we have, that with every advance in technology, for example, if quantum computers can be built, or if a new factoring algorithm is discovered, we have an additional dip that may render security very low. And so, why do I show this graph? This is not supposed to be a graph that should be against classical cryptographers. It's maybe rather a graph that should show why we are making all these investments in quantum cryptography. Why do we pay so much money into setting up an infrastructure? I mean, these satellites that we are discussing about are pretty expensive. Also, optical fibers are obviously much more expensive, or the type of connections I need is more expensive, like a point-to-point connection than the usual connections I have. So we are making a huge investment. Why are we doing it? It's really at the end that we can keep the security high, whereas with all conventional schemes we have this drop in security. And that's really why we need to calculate the epsilon, because if we couldn't state where this line is, then we lose all our advantages against classical cryptography. So the very point in doing quantum cryptography is that we can make a stronger security claim, so we need to calculate this epsilon. So this is all about motivation, why you should care about it. And let me now come to a more technical part. So far, let's say that this first part of the talk was really to make you aware of the fact that this epsilon is crucial. And we as a community should have an understanding what it means. I mean, if you sell a quantum crypto device at one of these booths outside to a customer, you need to understand what it's, I mean, you should have a label on it, a little stamp which says this device produces epsilon security and the epsilon has an actual number. So this is this thing we want. And now, of course, this comes now to the more, let's say, tutorial part. This was more the motivation for the tutorial part. What does this really mean? Let me come to a kind of more technical slide. And this is maybe what most people are here are perfectly aware of. How do we actually quantify this epsilon, or what is this epsilon? How is it defined? And one way to define it, and it's probably maybe more historical that this is the way it's defined, because later I will show equivalent definitions, which I phrase as maybe theorems, but of course you could have started with those. So the idea is the following. What this graph shows, for example here on the left, is the probability distribution of the key. So more precisely, we have here any possible key. So for example, this bar would be the key consisting of all zeros, and this would be a key consisting of all zeros, and the last bit is a one, and so on. So there are all possible keys. So this would actually be a huge thing with 2 to the, let's say, 1 million and different bars for all, if I produce a key of 1 million bits. So it's an enormously huge graph. And each key has a certain probability, which is usually around 2 to the minus the key lengths, of course. So each bit, each key string, each particular string K should have roughly the same probability. Now, what does this probability mean? I, for the moment, make a simplification. I say here without if, but without if doesn't mean that I'm not caring about adversity. You should just think of, like, I fix a particular knowledge, piece of knowledge that the adversary could have. So I take a particular instance of knowledge, which may be hard to do in a fully quantum context, but as a simplification, let's suppose if has a particular piece of information and conditioned on this piece of information, she, if, would assign to each possible key value a probability of how likely it is from her point of view that the key has this particular value. Now, the desired situation would be that one, that we would have a perfectly uniform string. So from Eve's point of view, each value of the key, of the bit string that forms the key, should be equally likely. Now the idea is, of course, to say that the key is more secure the more similar its distribution is to that uniform distribution. So at the end, technically, it's really a difference or a distance between this probability distribution, the probability distribution of the real key, and the probability distribution of what you could call a perfect key, which is just a uniform bit string. And so there are now different measures to quantify distances between probability distributions, and one of these measures, which may sound a bit arbitrary in the first place, is the trace distance. So you could just say the security, let's quantify the security in terms of the trace distance between this probability distribution and this one. Now, you see this? I put it on purpose a bit, or in a way that sounds arbitrary, because I could have chosen a different distance measure. For example, you could ask, why not the fidelity, or why not the L2 norm, or any other crazy distance measure that you may come up with. There will be reasons for that. Let's just, for the moment, take this as the definition. It's the trace distance between the probability distribution of the real key and the uniform key. Okay, what is the trace distance? Yes, I will come to that. So thanks for the question, because this brings me essentially to the next slide. So what is the trace distance? The trace distance is essentially, this is just a graphical representation, so I didn't write down the formula. Do you want to hear the formula as well? So maybe you can, certainly you can easily reconstruct the formula from that. It's really, what you do is you just take the difference between the two probability distributions and the element-wise difference. So you just see how large this peak, for example, is, the third one, and you subtract this one here. And so this is the difference, and so on. So here, this was a smaller one. That's why the difference is kind of negative. But you don't count it as negative. What you do at the end is just you sum up the weights of these differences. And for conventional reasons, you also divide it by 2. And the reason for this factor 2, by the way, is that, as you can easily see by just comparing the two, at the end, the total weight of all these bars is, of course, 1, because it's a probability, and probabilities sum up to 1. So necessarily, these overshooting peaks have to have the same weight as this one which was missing. So you can either just only count the positive ones and sum them up, or only the kind of negative ones, or you count all of them and divide by 2. This is all an equivalent way of defining the trace distance in this graphical picture. By the way, please feel free to ask questions. This is really supposed to be a tutorial, and so therefore I think it's my obligation to take questions, but it's not only an obligation. I'm very happy to take questions, because this helps me explaining those things which are unclear. Okay, so why this trace distance? And for that, I have to go back a bit more or deeper into cryptography. What I'm now going to explain is very standard for all those who have a background in classical cryptography, but it's usually not so well known to those who come more from the physics field. It's the way cryptographers think about security. And this is now really similar to how classical cryptographers introduced that, or actually it's the very same idea. The idea is to kind of, when you have a box, like this black box that I showed on one of the first slides, you instead kind of dream of a perfect thing. So you just think of, let's suppose we have a perfect device. And this perfect device is this blue device. By the way, I was recently writing together with Arthur a review or kind of article on device-independent security, and this way of thinking always reminded me of how he saw this. He would always say, let's dream of something we don't have and then show we actually have it. And in that case, it was kind of perfect coins that have some magical behavior and so on. So here, let's just dream of the thing we would like to have, ideally, which is a device which is kind of distributed between Alice and Bob. So you should always interpret these graphs as this is kind of the link to Alice and this is the link to Bob. And in the middle, we have an axis. So this is the symbol that shows that also the adversary, Eve, has some access to the device. And actually, I should probably have drawn an arrow in both directions, because Eve could also influence the device. But let's, for simplicity, just to explain the concept, assume that it only produces, it outputs stuff to Eve. So now, what is this perfect device supposed to do? What it should do is, it outputs stuff here to all these parties. It outputs a bit string to Alice, a bit string to Bob, and maybe something to Eve. Now we have certain requirements to the device, and one requirement is that First of all, what Alice and Bob get should be identical. This is sometimes called correctness. There are different terms for that. But it's clear what it means. It means the key that Alice has is a correct copy of Bob's key and vice versa. And at the moment for this talk, I don't really want to go deeper into that because that's usually kind of trivial to verify. We can, for example, just... So even if you're not certain that this holds, you could just, for example, apply a hash function, compare them to check that this is correct. But that's anyway something that is not really the cryptographic part. In any channel from Alice to Bob, you have a certain error probability which would correspond to this not being true. But, and we know very well how to deal with that. I want to focus on the second part, which is the secrecy condition, which says that in this ideal device, the key that is output to Alice should really be uniform and completely independent of Eve. What does it mean? It just means that whatever pieces of information Eve gets, whatever quantum state or complicated thing, whatever happens in the whole environment, should be completely independent of what of this uniform string. So you could write this down technically. I didn't do that, but if you like, you could write what is the state of Eve conditioned on a particular value of the key. And this state should just always be the same independently of what that value is. That's what it means technically. So that's the secrecy condition of the ideal device. Now, of course, we will not have such an ideal device. So however much or however you try, hard you try, you will never be able to produce that device. There will always be, as I said, a certain error probability. So let me now come to this so-called real world, ideal world paradigm, which is kind of the basis of understanding what epsilon really means. It's, you now think of the real protocols, and the green box is what you actually have. It was the black box that I showed at the beginning. So it's the thing consisting of the black boxes. It would be the devices you sell to a customer. And here we still have this perfect key generation device. And in some way, you could really think of two worlds. And this will be useful, this way of thinking, because one should think of them as running kind of separately. There's no connection between them at the moment. So we have this real world in which we live, and we have the ideal world of which we dream. And here there's no question about, so this is kind of by definition secure, in the sense that we just put into the ideal world the thing we would like to have, whatever it is. And so whenever something is equal to what we have in the ideal world, it would be perfectly secure. And now, we can, however, in this case, where we have the real protocol, think of security as something which is now defined as how different these things are. And now to quantify what difference could mean is kind of a bit subtle. So what classical cryptographers would now typically do, and what they propose and do in this standard scenario, is to say that let's think of a game. And the game is what they call a distinguishing game. So let's suppose we have someone who is blindfolded or someone who is colorblind, let's say, and we give him one of these two boxes, but he doesn't see whether it's the actual QKD protocol or this perfect device. And then we let him play with the device. He can, for example, look at these keys and he can also see what the adversary gets. So this game is not played from the viewpoint of the adversary. That's important. It should be understood that the game is played for someone who has access to everything. So you really think you get K, you get E, and so on. But you're colorblind. But your task is to find out whether you were actually playing with this device, with the actual protocol, or the perfect device. And at the end of the day, once you have played with the device, you're supposed to tell your guess. So you could say, oh, I'm actually quite convinced I played with the QKD protocol, for example. And the probability larger than 1/2 that you guess correctly is essentially this epsilon that we are talking about, except, again, for a normalization factor of 2. So why 1/2? So, of course, if you play with them and are asked which one did you play with probability 1/2, you will make the correct guess even if the two devices are identical. But if they are identical, then the probability that you make the correct guess is, of course, exactly 1/2. So we are interested in how much better than 1/2 you are, and so that's essentially what people call the distinguishing advantage or the epsilon parameter. So it's kind of how well you can guess between the two. Now, I don't want here to go further into this distinguishing distinguishability definition. I would like to think of it in a different way, which I find personally even more convincing or more intuitive. Some people claim it's less intuitive, but maybe there are just cryptographers who are used about the other way of thinking. So let's see what you think. So the way I would like to think of it is the following. Let's suppose, again, we have these two devices. And now we would like to make, so again, maybe the definition, okay, this is just to remind you of the definition. So normally we would now, so the epsilon is defined as what's the distance between the two. And what classical cryptographers could show is that this trace, or that's actually a proof in quantum information at the end, but for the quantum protocols, that this trace distance between the two distributions corresponds to the distinguishing probability as I just explained it, so the distinguishing advantage. So this definition is usually motivated by the fact that the trace distance is the right measure because it corresponds to this more operational way of thinking of in terms of distinguishing probability. But as I said, I prefer to think of it in a different way, which is again an equivalent way. So there's no need to think in that way, but I think it's useful to do it. So before I said these two worlds are kind of disconnected, and still I would like to assume that we always live in one world. But let's now suppose that I could set up, like from the outside, two worlds. Every being, including an adversary, is always in one of the two worlds. So there's no adversary who can see two worlds. So there's an adversary in this world and one here. But let's suppose I'm kind of taken outside you and I kind of outside of the universe and see these two worlds. And let's now suppose I could kind of correlate the two worlds. Or maybe a different way of thinking of it is this is really the world as we see it, world means this is what's going on when we actually run a protocol. And this would kind of be a shadow world of which we just dream at the same time. Now, why am I saying that? There is a theorem which tells you the following, and I will just in a minute give you an intuition why this theorem holds, or a proof sketch, if you like. The theorem says the following. If a protocol is epsilon secure, according to the definition I gave before, so the trace distance definition, then this means the following. It means that I could essentially set up another world. So I'm given this world, and I now set up another world, which is a perfect world in the sense that here a perfect key is generated, which is independent of the adversary and uniformly distributed. But at the same time, this perfect world is actually identical to the real world, except with some small probability epsilon. Or in other words, I set up another world which is identical, so it means the key generated here is exactly the key that is generated in my real world. What the adversary gets in this shadow world is also the same as in what he gets in the real world. So it's essentially the same world with probability 1 minus epsilon, but with probability epsilon there's a difference. But this epsilon is kind of used to make this, to tweak this world a bit to make it perfect. So in other words, I have now a new scenario which consists of the two, which is somehow consisting of a perfect key generation device, which I don't have access to, and so on, but this just exists in my dreams, and the real one. But what I can claim is that whatever happens in the real world is actually identical to my best dreams with probability 1 minus epsilon. So that really now justifies in some way the way of thinking in terms of error probabilities. Or maybe before I go to this proof, let me say it like that. So the fail, I said now many times that one can understand the epsilon as the probability of a failure. And you could really do that here. You could now say that failure is the event, which is now a well-defined mathematical event, that the key that is generated is not in its value identical to the key generated by the perfect device. And that's very intuitive. That's really what you want. So if you have a QKD device, you have it here on the desk, and then you have another device which doesn't actually exist, but it's there as a dreamt one. And you know this perfect device will never be broken. It just generates perfect keys. And you also know this perfect device would actually always produce just the identical key as the one you really have, except with this small probability. Then you could say, whenever this is not the case, whenever they are not identical, I consider this as a failure. But in all other cases, I'm kind of certain that the right thing happens. So why is this, by the way, true? So it's very easy to actually prove this kind of theorem, and that's maybe my most, in that sense, technical slide. It's for those who are a bit familiar with these with probabilities, but it's not hard to understand. So it's again the same graph. So remember that the epsilon was defined essentially as the red area. Now, what I need to do in order to, and now for simplicity, I dropped the E. I could have the same graph, including conditioning on an adversary and so on, but let's just forget it for the moment to see the idea. So what I would do is I have this green key on the left, which is the real key, and I could now simulate a perfect device in such a way that I just define the key of the perfect device to be identical with the real key. So what I do is, you could think of whenever a key is generated, so I run the actual device, and my rule is whenever a key is generated that has a higher probability, or let's say if whenever a key is generated first that has the same probability, I just define the same key as the key in my ideal world. Whenever a key is generated by my real device which has a slightly higher probability than it should, then I don't always define K to be identical to K, the blue K to be identical to the green one, but with the overshooting probability, I take a different, I kind of just take a value of one of the things which has had too little weight. So in some way, what I do, I just put this weight here. All these weights here that are overshooting, put them here. So can you kind of see when you think about that, that it would be easy that if you know this, of course you don't know this distribution in practice, but if you knew the distribution, this is just a way to analyze it, you could from the green key K, by a process which reads this green key K, generate a new number K, which is in most cases identical to the green K, in all the blue cases, and only in the red cases deviates from it. So that's essentially the idea of how this theorem is proved. So the theorem really tells you we are identical to a perfect thing. And you could again think of this, let's say, nuclear power plant example. You could say this would be the real nuclear power plant, and here would be a perfect one that never has a core melt, for example. And now you could say, what does it mean that they are epsilon close? It means that the real one has exactly the same behavior as the identical one. So whenever I would look and look at all parameters, they are the same as in the ideal one, which never has a core melt, except with probability epsilon. And of course, in this probability epsilon, something bad could happen, because with probability epsilon, this could deviate from that, and a deviation could mean that there is a core melt now, because here there's never a core melt, but if it deviates with probability epsilon, then there's a possibility there. So we want to keep the epsilon small, but in all other cases, we know it's perfect. Okay, so that's maybe really the answer to the question of how should we understand the epsilon. If a protocol is epsilon secure, then the probability that it behaves differently from a perfect device is at most epsilon. Now, okay, this is now for the experts maybe more on security definitions, because what I did was kind of a classical version of the thing. And actually, the information that Eve has is quantum mechanical. And I just want to show this briefly for those who are aware of this quantum version, that there is also a quantum version of this theorem, which is a bit more complicated, but essentially the same idea, that if I have a real-world protocol described by a state which describes the distribution of the key and the information accessible to the adversary, E, then I could still compare it to the ideal world, which is also described by a quantum state. This quantum state would, by the way, be a factored state where K and E are independent of each other. And now what one can define is, again, a joint world, kind of. This is this black state in such end events such that the green, the real world, occurs, can be generated from this joint world by conditioning on this green event, and the perfect world can also be obtained by conditioning, and these events have again very high probability. So with very high, in that sense, I could again, even in the quantum case, make the statement that the real and the ideal device are identical with probability 1 minus epsilon.
Now, why
did I insist so much on this interpretation in terms of failure probability? The main reason is really that this allows us to easily compose things together. Because at the end, as you know, whatever security measure you have for a QKD device, at the end, you're not just interested in the QKD device. What you're interested in, actually, is in some way the use of the device, for example, to send messages securely. And so what you're really interested in is how likely it is that an adversary gains a message which is supposed to be secret. And you're not interested in the trace distance between things. And more generally speaking, and by the way, this is also true, again, for nuclear power plants and any other engineering thing, when we build something, it has several components, and each building block, let's say the parts of an airplane, has a certain probability to fail. Now, let's suppose, this is now kind of the non-redundant case. So let's suppose we have a device that consists of these building blocks, and they all depend on each other. If each building block has a probability fail of a certain probability epsilon, here numbered by the number of the building block, then in the worst case, the probability that the whole thing fails is, of course, the sum of all the epsilons, because they depend all on each other. If one fails, the whole thing may fail. So, however, this is kind of a safe estimate. So we can say that if we calculate the sum of all the individual failures, sum them up and get this number, then we can be certain that this is the maximum failure probability of the overall device. So this is even true when the things are unfavorably correlated. So an unfavorable correlation means that whenever this breaks, this doesn't break. That's worse than if they break at the same time, because that would, of course, then lead to a smaller total probability. So the worst thing is if they break whenever the others don't break. But even in that case, it's just the sum of the failure probabilities. So that's very intuitive, and because we can now interpret the epsilon of QKD as a failure probability, then we can apply the same reasoning to the understanding of protocols. And actually, we can also use it to get the parameter in the first place. Because as you know, a protocol is, of course, built up from several sub-protocols. For example, a QKD protocol consists of a part which first estimates the errors in the channel. And there is a part which does, for example, error correction. And then there is a part on privacy amplification. There may be additional things like advantage distillation. They all have their own probabilities of failure. And at the end, when we do a security proof, what we need to do is to calculate the probability of failure, or the epsilon, for each of these individual building blocks. That's really the task that we are doing. That's what I used to do when I was young and worked at home. So I calculated these error probabilities. Now, once you have them, you just sum them up, and this gives you the epsilon for the protocol. This is what you would write down on the final certificate for your devices. So, now, for the individual things, there are, of course, different techniques. So, for example, parameter estimation is essentially how well did you estimate the error in the channel. As you can imagine, this is kind of a classical estimation problem. And the error here, this is important to understand, is not the deviation from the estimated channel behavior from the real one. It's more like when you do an estimation, you say, the noise in the channel is maybe is below, let's say, 2%. this is a statement, maybe it's only 1% or so, but then the epsilon is not the 2%. The epsilon is the probability by which the estimate 2% was wrong. So it's the probability that the actual error in the channel is larger than 2%. And this is usually a very small number, so or you can make it a very small number. So a typical value for epsilon is 10 to the minus 8. So the statement would be in this first round that with probability epsilon, which is 2 to the minus 8, 10 to the minus 8, let's say, if the channel estimated an error of 2%, then for certain the actual error is below of the channel, the noise is below 2%. That's what this means here. For error correction, it's similar. This, of course, depends on the quality of the error correction code, so you can also make it very small. So that's the probability by which, after error correction, something went wrong. For example, the two strings that Alice and Bob have are not identical. This can, again, be easily made small by using good error correcting codes. Then let me, as an example, because now I just stated that kind of informally, say a bit more about privacy amplification. So what is privacy amplification? This is usually the last step in the protocol where one says that one has already something called a raw key, and usually one has already calculated its entropy or estimated its entropy, and one, suppose we have this estimate, it's at least a certain number h. And then what privacy amplification does, so privacy amplification is now essentially applying certain suitably chosen hash function, it produces the final n-bit key. And so again, this procedure may fail with a certain probability, and the probability by which it fails is given again by a statement. And in this case, it's a theorem, which we call the hashing or two universal hashing theorem, which would state that, again, the error, I mean, the exact formula is not so important, but the error that you make, so the failure probability, the probability by which this is not uniform, despite of the fact that the input satisfied this condition, is small. So how small is it? Here you can see a typical behavior. So how small it is something which has an exponent. And you see in the exponent there's an h, and h is the entropy. So the entropy is something, it's like a resource. The more signals you distribute between Alice and Bob, the more entropy you have. So you can easily make this exponent large. Of course, the larger key you generate, the more resources you need. But you see the difference between the two, the difference between h and n tells you how secure you can make your key. And therefore, you see, it's usually not so hard, at least in theory, to make this epsilon quite small. You just invest a little bit more entropy to make this small. So the epsilons can really be made small, which leads to the, and as I said, at the end, oops, we have this, these epsilons add up. So you should really think of these epsilons as all of the order of 10 to the minus 8, and at the end you sum up three such small epsilons, so you still are of the order of 10 to the minus 8, roughly, for example. But, okay, why do I say 10 to the minus 8? The question is really, how should we choose the epsilon? And here, it's important that, and this is, I think, something that Norbert always emphasizes, the epsilon is, of course, always depending on the amount of key we really consider. So I usually think of it in that way. I get this device and I press a button and then I get a key of a certain length, let's say 1 million bit key. And the probability that this particular key that I generated is now insecure is now given by the epsilon value for that particular key. But maybe I use this device in an application several times. Maybe I need it, I use it 1 billion times. So this would be this n here. Then, of course, the probability that in one of these uses something went wrong is, of course, that multiplied by this number, which is already kind of a quite large number. But this is really the relevant number. So if I do something in an application, I want to, at the end, very end, be certain that the application is secure, then I have to make sure that the epsilon is sufficiently small such that if I multiply it with the number of uses of the devices, the number I get is still small.
Now, again, the question is how to choose that number. Why did I choose 1/1000?
That's, of course, a matter of taste. At the end, I need a certain security. And it's maybe a matter of taste. It's a matter of how much I'm ready to pay for the insurance, so to speak. And to get an understanding of this number, I come again back to this nuclear power plant example. And there, the number is actually 1/1000. So what do I mean by that? So each nuclear power plant has a certain probability of failing in 1 year. So actually, according to some guidelines from the 80s, which are probably outdated, in Germany, a nuclear power plant should be guaranteed not to have a core melt except with that small probability. Now, of course, a nuclear power plant is several years in operation, so you need to multiply this by the number 50. I mean, by the number of years it's in operation, then you can calculate how likely it is that the nuclear power plant has actually a core melt. Now, this looks like a pretty large number, and it's actually, nevertheless, unfortunately, a realistic number, because if you multiply it with the number of nuclear power plants in the world, then you get something of the order 1/10. So every year there's a chance of 1/10 that there is somewhere in the world a nuclear core melt, which somehow, at least as an order of magnitude, is actually what happened. So you can now say that if you choose for your QKD device this, then you are at least as secure as nuclear power plants, which is in some way at least a guideline for how to choose these things. Okay, so this brings me almost to the end. So maybe this slide here is really the starting point of when you would kind of start backwards, which is maybe recommended if you're a user of QKD. Because if you are a user of QKD, you should first ask yourself, what is the risk you can take? How likely, what is still an acceptable chance of the scheme to fail, where failure could mean anything. It could mean that the whole key leaks. Then you set this number, and then you go backwards and calculate the epsilon. So this depends on the number of users, so you get an epsilon. And then you have to ask your provider or the guy who does the security proof to prove or to show which parameters, what resources are needed in order to achieve that epsilon. And then you put in these resources and generate your keys. Okay, that's essentially it. So I come back to my initial take-home messages that I mentioned. So the point is security is finite, that's unavoidable. But the epsilon can very easily be made arbitrarily small. And so in that sense, it's of course justified to say that QKD still essentially, for all practical purposes, gives us security as a key that is as secure as a perfect key. But we need to understand how to quantify, of course, this resemblance. So whenever we have a positive epsilon, security only means something if you understand what this epsilon means. And what it means is that it's the probability that we have a deviation from a perfect key. Okay, that was all. Thank you. I'm not sure what the timing is.
Thank you very much. Yeah, we have 10 o'clock. We have ample time for questions. I see Gilles has a question.
Thank you, Renato. Very nice. I have one issue with you're talking about the probability of at least 1 bit leaking. And my issue is that there could be less than 1 bit, but still more than zero in information theory.
Yes, I agree. So this was maybe okay, when I said 1 bit, this was just to illustrate that it could be only 1 bit, but indeed it could even be less. So actually what this guarantees is really, so what we have with probability 1 minus epsilon, nothing leaks. So with probability epsilon, it could be that 0.001 of a bit is leaking in that sense. But you see, what it means that nothing leaks, so there's one
issue that one has to understand, which is maybe a cause of this debate that I showed at the beginning. So let's suppose we have just one bit of a key that we generate. And now let's suppose that I say that the probability that an adversary, that this, my scheme fails is 1/2. So what does it mean? It means now, according to what I said, that with probability 1/2, this key that I generate, this one-bit key, is still identical to a perfect key. So what does it mean? It could mean that the bit is always a zero. And then, of course, with probability 1/2, it's still identical to a perfect key. But this is fine, because you see, when I at the end use it in an application, and I prove that the application works at the end, let's say whenever I use a perfectly random bit, then I can still conclude from that if I always put in a zero in the application, the probability that the application fails is at most 1/2. So you should
not if the eavesdropper knows that, of course.
Pardon?
Not if the eavesdropper knows this.
Yes, but yes, that's right. But you see, the adversary can always make the guess. So even in the case where he doesn't know, he could make the guess that it's zero, even if it was a perfect key, and would, of course, with probability 1/2 be right. So maybe this is another way of saying the same thing, that if I have an application with which produces only one, based on only one key bit, then even in the perfect case, the adversary could, of course, with probability 1/2 correct, guess it right. Now when I say that the failure probability is 1/2, it means that already in the perfect case, he has a probability of 1/2 of guessing. So in addition, it fails with probability 1/2. So now I have a total probability that he could guess of 1. So what one shouldn't do, this is maybe another related point, is one shouldn't think of conditioned on the event that there was no failure, the key is still uniform. That would be a wrong statement. So the statement is really the one, someone has to really be careful of taking it in, understanding it exactly that way, that it's conditioned on not, on no failure. It's identical to what the perfect device produced. Now, of course, conditioned on no failure also may change the probability. I mean, if I really did the conditioning, may change the behavior of the perfect device. But that's not relevant, because I could just analyze the perfect device without the conditioning and see how it's used. And if at the very end, let's say something bad happens, someone steals your bank account, with the perfect device, and I can bound this probability to be, let's say, smaller than 1/100, then it's still true conditioned. Maybe I should phrase it in a different way. So let's suppose you use your key for something to protect your bank account. Now you do a calculation and you can show that if it was a perfect key, there is still some way of the adversary to break into your bank account, but this probability is, let's say, 1/100. Now, what you still can guarantee is that if you now use a real key, which deviates by epsilon, which has a failure probability of epsilon, then the probability of the adversary breaking into your bank account is 100 plus epsilon. So the failure probabilities just add up. So, you know, it's not the claim that in the ideal world there is no failure of the use of this perfect key at all. So even using a perfect key could lead to something going wrong, maybe because the adversary guesses the perfect key correctly. So this is not part of this epsilon. So the epsilon is really the probability by which it deviates from the perfect device and not taking into account things that already go wrong with the perfect device.
That's all right. A different small technical point. Mm-hmm. When you say that the final epsilon is the sum of all the epsilons along the way, of course you mean it's less than or equal to that sum.
That's a good point. So I put on purpose an equal, because the epsilon should always be understood as
at least, so you see it in this theorem. So the epsilon should be understood as a bound, because I can never determine the epsilon. So I also don't want to make a claim. If I say the security is epsilon, it's not my aim to claim that actually with probability epsilon really something goes wrong. I just want to have it as a bound that at most with probability epsilon something goes wrong. So in this sense, epsilons are always bounds. That's why I can say if a cryptographic scheme has security 0.01, it also has security 0.1 in that sense.
Right. Sorry to take more time.
No, I have enough time.
Well, I don't know if other people want to ask questions, but so really what you say is, back to the first question, that except with probability epsilon, the eavesdropper knows nothing. Mm-hmm. Because in the early days, what Charlie and I developed, it was the mm-hmm. amount of Shannon information uh-huh. that the eavesdropper would know, mm-hmm. which made it possible that with probability 1, he knew an exponentially small amount of information. Mm-hmm. But in your framework, with probability 1 minus epsilon, he knows nothing at all, which is quite different from what we did. And it's better, in a sense.
Yes,
I like it better, but I'm surprised because that's not mm-hmm. what we had initially.
Yes, so I think that you could say if you would just talk about the key itself, which you of course did at that time, then there are several measures which make a lot of sense. For example, to talk about the mutual information. The problem is really that if you, for example, so the mutual information will never be zero, as you know. So if it's small, it's hard to kind of really tell what that means. Now for, let's say, if you use the key, because the mutual information being epsilon could either mean that with probability maybe 100 epsilon, the mutual information is actually 1 over 100, or it could mean that with probability 1/100th of an epsilon, the mutual information is 100 times it. So you could see there could be a trade-off. The final mutual information is kind of the probability by which something leaks times the amount that leaks. And you can no longer separate the two. And the amount that leaks, that was kind of my point, and the severeness of things, is something we are not so much interested in, because indeed it could be as bad to leak 1 bit, or even 0.1 bit, if you like, as leaking, or maybe I should say, leaking 1 million bits could certainly be not, or put it like that. If I, for example, send my bank account information, maybe my password is in, let's say, 100 bits or 200 bits somewhere. But maybe the whole communication I do is 1 million bits. So if these 100 bits leak, this is equally bad as if all the 1 million bits leak. That's why we are not really interested in the all amount.
Right. All right. If I may, one thing that you said at the very beginning but did not come again about it is the link between the length of the final key mm-hmm. and this epsilon, that the bigger the key is, the smaller epsilon becomes.
You mean this final?
That you had at the very beginning, but you didn't talk about that afterwards.
At the beginning? Okay, now I'm not sure. So, sorry, this was not the, you mean this graph here. The n was not supposed the key, the length of the final key, this was really the resource. So it's, for example, the number of communication steps I do. Or you could, so n would, for example, really be how many rounds of the protocol of the key exchange or entanglement distribution in entanglement-based protocol are played.
Charlie?
So I think what you've been saying, in which I agree with, is that the trace distance, instead of being a less conservative of way of estimating failure, is a more conservative way and more composable.
More than what?
Composable.
Then composable, or
it composable. In other words, if you have something that has a failure probability in terms mm-hmm. of trace distance of 10^-8, mm-hmm. and you use it, you're not going to accidentally surprise yourself of getting
right.
something that fails more often.
Yes, right.
So
that's
there's
right.
There's a sort of serious misunderstanding about this. It is a better way of doing it than we did it.
Then instead of a worse way. Yes. Yeah. Right. Yes. Yes, you're not suddenly, yes, because otherwise it could be that it's kind of suddenly you get a larger number in this term. So it's really this sum rule that will never surprise you in that sense. So maybe this. So,
Thomas, there's one question there. Was there some other question back there as well?
No, Thomas, please. Can I ask about the so when you were connecting these real world and ideal worlds, mm-hmm. so in the classical case, you gave a nice way to think about it, mm-hmm. which is this transfer of probability that mm-hmm. you explained.
Yes.
So in the right, so I was going to ask about the quantum case, if you can give a way or how do you think about this? So how are mm-hmm. these events defined, mm-hmm. and yes. why is that particular theorem a satisfactory theorem in terms of yes. the
mm-hmm. Yes. So let me maybe first say something a bit more technical. So the way this all is color coded. So there are essentially three objects, just to make it. So rho k is this new thing that I construct, and together with events, and the green and the blue ones are kind of the given ones. So the theorem is really these two are given, and I construct these new ones such that with events I can get them. So technically, this rho ke is essentially constructed as the state which is larger in the sense of, like, as a density operator, larger or equal than that and that one. So it's kind of, so the difference, it's at first place no longer a normalized state, but you could think of this as an operator which is kind of at the same time larger than this and that, but the minimal one which has this property. So, and then you renormalize it. That's just a remark about how it's constructed, so that you get the impression. So what the way you can think of it is really, in some way, one could maybe in some way think of it as a, or let me first say something why it's needed. So let's suppose we have just two states here, and you don't need to think about keys and so on. Let's just, it's about trace distance. So let's say this is a state that is just a zero in some computational basis, and this is has also a one component with some small epsilon. So it's a slightly turned state. Now, of course, it's almost impossible, or it's not possible to say that the two are equal, even if I condition on something, because the state will never turn whatever I condition on. But what I can do is kind of generate a mixed state, which contains a component in the zero direction and one component in the one direction, such that if I condition it correctly, it will give these two states, depending on what I have. Now you asked about the meaning of that. So the meaning, one could think of it as, so I cannot really define events that connect the two, but I could kind of think of an intermediate world. So I could, in some way, draw a box in between the two, let's say a new box here in the middle, and which would be governed by this rule. So it would be, the behavior of that new box would be the one constructed by this rule K, this black rule. And now, for the connection between this new box I would have drawn here and that one, essentially almost the same as I said for the classical case would hold. So this, in this new box, there is a certain event, and if this event occurs, the behavior is really identical to that one. So the instance, so it's exactly identical. But, and the same, this box here that I would draw condition on another event is really identical to that one. So now I could think of these events as, if you like, I could really have a box with two lights on it, and let's say these are warning lights. And usually when no warning light is on, it means that the behavior is identical to the boxes. So let's say there's a green warning light and a blue warning light. Whenever the green warning light flashes up, then I know now there's a deviation to the green box. Whenever the blue warning light flashes, there's a deviation to the blue box. But the warning lights almost never flash. They only flash with each of them with probability epsilon. So I could now think of operationally I have this box, and as long as I don't see the warning light, everything is identical. And I see the warning lights almost never, so I shouldn't care of what happens in these cases. Of course, once it flashes, then there's something different. So I can really, so this is the closest to bring it back to this classical intuition, that I could really think of a new device, which is now not the perfect device, but it's a device which tells me as long as the warning lights don't flash, this device is identical to the ideal device, and it's also identical to the real one. So I use kind of an intermediate one, in some way, for this technical reason that two states can never be made equal conditional on the event. But I could still think of this in the same way. I also think in this classical case, by the way, I didn't say that, I could really think of here, this device has a little light, a warning light. And this light has probability epsilon. Whenever the light doesn't flash, then I know that precisely the key that is output here, not only the probability distribution, but really the keys output are identical. And whenever the light flashes, I know there is a problem, but this happens very rarely. So this same intuition is then transferred to the quantum case, but I need this intermediate device for, okay, yes, technical reasons, I would say. If I knew the behavior, I could, in practice, they cannot. It's really, that's why, that's a very good point. That's why I want this epsilon to be really very small. Because then I can say, I don't care that I don't know whether the light now flashes, because I know in most of the cases it anyway doesn't. So it's kind of a light that never, in practice, should never flash up. So I don't need it at the end. I just needed to think of it.
So there are some more questions.
Professor Greiner, I have a question. Is it a special case or a general case that for a composability, a different epsilon of different blocks can be added? Is it a special case?
Pardon, I didn't acoustically understand the full question. Can you repeat it, please?
My question is, in composability, the epsilon I of different blocks can be undid. Is it a special case or a general case?
So you're saying if I do composal proofs, there are epsilons for different parts. So I guess you're referring to this situation here. And now, I think what one can say is that generally, I could take this picture of the light bulbs, the warning light. So I could think of each building block has this warning light in principle, which, as Phil said, I couldn't build, but let's think of them. Now, these would flash sometimes with these probabilities epsilon. Now they could be all correlated, these flashing light. So the best case would actually be if they would all flash at the same time, because then the overall probability would just be the maximum of these individual probabilities. That would be the best case. But because we cannot expect to be in the best case, we have to take the worst case, which is if they are also correlated, but anti-correlated in the sense that they flash all at different times. So if they would be unrelated or uncorrelated, I would have a slightly better expression. I would have some expression where I have here epsilons multiplied with the 1 minus epsilon of the other epsilons, but I wouldn't gain much. But in principle, if I knew that they were unrelated, I could do that to gain a little bit. But because the epsilon is a very small number, the gain would be of a second order, like epsilon squared, which is irrelevant.
Thank you.
Yes, I have a question regarding the picture where you have the constantness of epsilon for a QPD system. If you take into account that the model of your QPD system might not be perfect, which of course is the case because models are always a finite model and probably the real system has more degrees of freedom. That means if the model would improve over time, that could probably also lead to a decrease of the epsilon.
So is it this picture?
Yes.
Okay.
Because the assumption is that the eavesdropper doesn't learn or doesn't improve his model, or that the side channel is not detected later on.
Okay, that's a very good point because I didn't probably stress it or I didn't say it even. So the epsilons that I was now talking about are to be understood as epsilons that I prove under certain assumptions, and the assumptions I could understand as for example, that I have a perfectly implemented device. Now, the nice thing about the epsilon is you can now add up other epsilons which come, for example, from the probability that the device fails itself, for example, the hardware fails for some reason and does something unexpected. So, indeed, it's true that in this epsilon, this doesn't. So this would be the security you get if the assumptions hold perfectly. And of course, what you're kind of saying is that if there are, for example, side channel attacks and so on, then the epsilon would decrease. But it's not this epsilon here. So this would be the epsilon based on these assumptions. I would say there is another epsilon which I have to add to that, which is the epsilon that quantifies how, what is the probability that my assumption fails. And of course, that epsilon is very hard to control in practice. That's why one should probably also go for to device-independent QKD to really solve the problem. But that would just be added. So I could really think of, again, component-wise or proof-wise as a modular thing. So I have the probability assigned to the individual assumptions. They may also fail. And I add up all these epsilons. And then I get the final epsilon, which is maybe really relevant to the customer, is, of course, including the epsilon of the assumption, which I didn't consider here because I don't know how to quantify it. But it's, of course, true that this is something to be taken very seriously, and one should try to quantify that as well.
Okay, thank you. Maybe chance for one last question. Anyone? Okay, that's not
okay,
the case.
That's great.
So then first let's thank Renato again, and then there will be some announcements.
Okay, thank you.